Hi, this is Dr. Cindy First from the University of Utah, and today I'm going to talk about modeling transmission lines with the finite difference time domain method. We've done a lot of work with FDTD in the past, and this time we'd like to apply it to transmission lines, and there are some unique nuances that we're going to talk about today. So first let's draw our transmission line model. We begin with a generator, and we're just going to take a generator with its internal impedance. It has a voltage VG and a resistance, internal resistance RG, and that's going to be the model for the generator. We're then going to connect that to a transmission line, which has some length and some impedance, and we're going to use the RLGC model in order to be able to model that transmission line, and then we're going to connect that onto a load, ZL. So let's draw what our model of an RLGC transmission line looks like. Well, typically we put an R, an L, a G, which is conductance, and a C, which is capacitance. So this is R, L, G, and C. And I'm going to specifically mark these with primes because this is resistance per unit length, as in ohms per meter, inductance per unit length, conductance per unit length, and capacitance per unit length. Now when we're modeling a transmission line, this little piece right here is of length delta Z. So this entire length right here is going to be a length that we're going to model Z from Z equals 0 here all the way out to Z equals L. on the far end. And when we model this, we actually put several of these unit cells together, like this. And each of these unit cells, we add all of those together, that's going to make our transmission line. So there's one unit cell, here's another unit cell, and here's another, and so on. There's another way that we can model this, and in fact we're going to in this case. To make this more symmetric, we can break it right down here, and so we can actually put half of our conductance and capacitance over here, then the resistance and inductance, the other half of the resistance and capacitance here. So this is G prime over 2 and C prime over 2, G prime over 2 and C prime over 2, and then of course the R prime and the L prime. And this could be our unit cell. This model is actually going to work better for our application because it's symmetric. So you're going to see that that's the model that we're going to be using. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to break into one of these unit cells and I'm going to talk about how we're going to divide the RLGCs within the cell. So let's take a look at that next. So right here I've got my transmission line and I'm going to model it like this, as I mentioned. Like so. And this is of length delta Z, and I'm going to model this as location V of 1, and this location V of 2. So our voltages are going to be at two separate locations on the end of our little transmission line segment, and then we're going to model the current right here moving from left to right, and this is going to be I of 1. Effectively, we can consider that to be in between the middle of V1 and V2. So if I modeled these using the k's that I'm showing you in the derivations, this would be V of k, this would be V of k of 1, and this would be I of k, but notice that the current is in between the two voltages. That's actually really important to our derivations when we're doing them here. Now what I'm going to do is connect up my generator. There's my RG and here is my VG, like so. But I'm going to actually change my generator model. So instead of using this, I'm going to use the Norton equivalent for it. So I'm going to change this to be a current source right here and a parallel resistor. So this is going to be VG divided by RG, and this is going to be RG. And that's the same model for my generator. I'm then going to hook that up that to my half conductance and capacitance, to my resistance and my inductance, and here's the other half over here, and then the rest of the transmission line. So again, right here is where I'm modeling V of 1, and right here is where I'm modeling V of 2. So that allows us to consider the RLGC model and the specific locations of the currents and the voltages. And so this would be like I of 1 right here. So a very important change in order to do our simulation. And you're going to see why I'm going to choose to use this symmetric model in just a minute. So just remember, this is G prime over 2, C prime over 2, G prime over 2, C prime over 2, and this is R prime, and this is L prime. So that's how we're going to be modeling our transmission lines. Pay very special attention to the location for each of these currents and voltages. Now let's also talk about the time. So when we're modeling this right here, so it's kind of like having V of K and V of K plus 1, and then right there is I of K, and that's our cell. We also need to consider where these are in time. So this is where they are in space, but let's consider where they are in time. Oh, and I also wanted to talk about exactly what is Z in meters. So Z in meters is represented by this V of 1. The reason I'm going to use V of 1 is because I'm going to program it in MATLAB, and it's very convenient to start MATLAB matrices with 1, less convenient to start with them with 0. So we can see that V of 1 starts out at Z equal to 0. So when I'm calculating my Z in meters, it is K minus 1 times my delta Z. That's very important to keep track of where those are. And then right here, so this is for the voltages, and if I want to consider the location of the voltage of the current, where is I at that location, that's actually going to be at K minus a half times delta Z, because it's half a cell further than the voltages. So there they are in space. Now let's talk about them in time. So remember, I've got this generator right here, however I've modeled it, whichever model I choose to use. I've got the G, the C, the R, and the L. So much like this, there's my model again. Remember that right here I've got V of K, V of 1, and over here I have V of K plus 1, and right here I have I of K. Well, let's also talk about time. So when I'm modeling my voltages and currents in time, I'm going to draw a time axis kind of going down like this. The first thing that we calculate is actually the, so right here we start out at time n equals 0, which is the same thing as saying that time is equal to n times delta t. We're going to have sampled this signal. So maybe here's my voltage signal, and I've got two samples, and the distance between them is delta t, or dt on a time axis. So the sampling of my voltages and currents is going to kind of happen like this. The voltages are going to be sampled in red, in black, and the currents are going to be sampled in red, like this. So they're offset in space and they're offset in time. So right here is going to be my first voltage. That is going to be the voltage at n equals 0 at some location. And then here's going to be the voltage at n equals 1, and then the voltage at n equals 2, and so on. So this is n. The current, meanwhile, is going to be sampled in between. So right there, this is going to be the current at n plus a half, and the current at n plus 3 halves, and so on. So the way I start my simulation in FDTD is I actually assign these voltages at 0 to be equal to 0, with the exception of the source. So my source can actually start out at time t equal to 0, but everything is set to 0 at my first, at n equals 0. And then this is the first calculation that I'm going to do. So I'm going to calculate at n plus a half, and then I'm going to calculate the voltage at n, then I'm going to calculate the current at n plus 3 halves, and the voltage at n, and so on. So it's going to go kind of like this. Oops, this should be, n equals 1, n equals 2. So you can see how this time progression is going to happen. This is very important to keep track of each of these equations and at what time they are actually calculated. So pay attention especially to this timing in our next video. So basically what I've talked about right now is the fact that we have our voltages and currents separated like this in space. And this is one cell, delta Z, and that cell looks like this. That's our delta Z cell right there. So this picture and this are telling us the same information. And then we've also talked about the time. That's going to be an index that's going to be up here. So there's going to be a V at n, and I is going to be calculated at n plus a half, and then this is going to be calculated again at n. Actually, let me say this is n plus 1. So it's very important to keep track of both the space and the time. In the next video, I'm going to talk about how we model this generator and how we terminate our FDTD equations on the left. So join me for the very next video in just a minute.